So adaptive script writing, like basically what that means, the reason I don't call myself a script writer is because I'm not creating my own story, right? It already exists. So what I'm doing is I'm adapting it to a Western culture and to the English language. So let's say, okay, there is Ninja Show Spectacular in Japan, and everybody wants this show because it's fabulous. And Funimation doles out a whole wad of cash, and they get Ninja Show Spectacular. Well, then what happens is, you know, depending on whether it's a broadcast dub, I'm not sure exactly how that works, so I'll talk about DVD dubs because that's what I know. Then once they've signed all the paperwork and done all of that and exchanged monies, the Japanese will send over usually the video, their scripts that they used in the booth, any kind of art materials that our art department might need for like marketing purposes and stuff like that, and any kind of other excess tracks that we might need, like sound effects tracks and things like that. Then what happens is our translation team usually gets the raw video with the Japanese, and then hopefully they get the script. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. And then they go through and translate. And the way we have it set up is that it's usually two translators go over each script. So you'll have like a native Japanese speaker who speaks English and then a native English speaker who speaks Japanese. Because what's going to happen is there's going to be nuances in the language that one or the other doesn't pick up. Or there might be references that the Japanese native Japanese speaker doesn't quite understand, you know, English equivalents to. So we're very thorough in that respect. Then, from there, there's this lovely gentleman named Michael Harcourt, who is a dear friend of mine, who then decides, like, who's going to work on it and everything. He sends all that information over to John Bergmeier, who is our head writer. He's, like, the grand poopah of writing at Funimation. He's also a fabulous voice actor. He was Freed in Fairy Tail and Johan and Shana, Shakugan Oshana. Like, he's in a lot of stuff. Anyway, he's in Dragon Ball. Who's he in Dragon Ball? What's that guy's name? With the one eye. Tien. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's right. Three eyes. Hello. But yeah, he is the lead writer or the head writer. So it's his job to decide, okay, I've got Ninja Show Spectacular. This is a show about ninjas. It's a period piece. So it's going to require a lot of research and development. Monica should work on Ninja Show Spectacular, because if you haven't figured out already, Jamie Markey gets to do a lot of the comedy. Michael Tatum gets to do anything that needs, you know, four syllable words or Scrabble words. And then anything that requires a lot of research or is like the third season out of four and we're going to start in the middle, or anything that's difficult, I get. Yeah, I don't know how that happened. Unless every once in a while I get a booby show, because I like to write the booby shows. I think they're fun. So every once in a while I'll get a Sunran Kagura, but then they send me right back to whatever is most difficult or long running, like Fairy Tail. So I get Ninja Show Spectacular, and then he'll tell me like whoever is going to be working underneath me. So like Josh Greeley works very closely with me usually. I trained Aaron Dismuke. I've got certain writers that Jeremy Kratz right now is a great, he's also a young adult author, and he works for me as one of my writers. So John will comprise my team. And then he'll tell me, okay, well, you've got, I'm going to give this episode to you and this episode to him and this episode to him, and, you know, split it up. I'll usually write the first episode, if not the first two episodes, to try and set the scene, like to make sure that the characters are solid and the way they need to be, that any plot points or licensor terms, sometimes we get terms from the licensor on shows like Fairy Tail or Tokyo Ghoul, and they'll say, this is what this needs to be called and why. So it's my job to make sure all of that stuff sticks. So then everybody writes their individual scripts. They send them to me, and then it's my job to go over all of these scripts and edit them and make it sound like one person wrote all of them. So, you know, to make sure all of your characters sound the same, to make sure that, again, those terms are all the same. But yeah, that's my job, is to make it sound like it was just one person working on all of it. Lately, I haven't had as much time to write, so I've been solely editing, and Jamie Markey and I have been doing a lot of that. We've been training new folks and then also concentrating on the editing aspect. Then once that's done and John gives his okay on the scripts, then it goes into the booth, and that's when they have auditions and cast it, and then they start recording it. And that's how a show gets made. So the actual process of writing, like when you get a script, like let's say you were working for me and you had a script of Ninja Show Spectacular that you had to write. What you would receive is the raw video with a time code on it. You guys know what a time code stamp is, right? The little numbers in the top. And then you would get a document. We have a blank document that's kind of like the basic script. And then depending on whether or not you had a time coder or not, you would have to time code it. We now have a group of people that are paid solely to time code. And what that means is that whenever somebody opens their mouth or makes a sound or anything, a line starts, you have to go down to the exact frame where the mouth opens or where you first hear the sound of their voice speaking and write down that time code for every single line, reaction, everything, because Funimation uses the beep system, and in order to have the beeps perfect, you have to know exactly when that mouth opens. So it's really time consuming and tedious, and nobody likes to do it, so that's why we now have people that are paid solely to do that, so that the writers don't have to worry about that anymore. Then, if you do get somebody to time code your script, what you end up getting is a script that has time codes and character names and the reactions put in, so it'll say like, OM laughing for open mouth laughing, or CT anger for clenched teeth anger, just so that you have an idea of what's going on. Then it's your job as the writer to take the translation, make sure that it's matched up to where, you know, your time codes and everything. And then you have to make that translation make sense in English, one. And I don't know if many of you have read translations, but sometimes they can sound like Yoda. So you have to make it sound like regular conversation. You have to make sure that the intent of what's being said is conveyed in the line that you've written. But you also need to make it sound like a conversation. And unfortunately, a lot of times translations come across as statement, 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 because that's kind of how the Japanese language is, just as a language as a whole. When you go directly by translation, it very much sounds like two people in the same room talking, but not necessarily talking to one another. So that's one of our jobs as adapters, is to go, hey, I'm going to have this person ask a question, and then that person's going to answer it, and then this person's going to interject, and that way it sounds more organic. It sounds like people actually talking to one another. We also do things like to help westernize it, because the languages are so different. Sometimes you, if you're familiar with Japanese at all, you know that sentence structure is usually flipped. So what is at the beginning of our sentences is usually at the end. Kind of like if you speak Spanish, you know, like the adjectives come before the noun here, whereas over there, sometimes the adjectives come afterwards and things like that. Also, it's very polite, you know, in the Japanese language to say the name of the person you're speaking to. So if I were having a conversation with Brett, it would be very polite of me to say, hello, Brett, how are you doing? Well, I'm doing fine today, Monica, how are you? Great, Brett, what are you going to do for the rest of your day? Well, Monica, I'm going to do this. That's just inherent in the Japanese language. If you do that in English, you sound like two idiots. You know what I mean?
I've heard a couple of anime where they keep the suffixes from Japanese.
Like the honorifics and stuff? Right. A lot of that depends on who we think the audience is going to be. So like, especially with Funimation, I know some of the other studios tend to leave those in a little bit more, but with Funimation, we kind of brand the titles. So like a show like Oron High School Host Club, we know that Joe Schmo is not gonna walk into Best Buy and go, that one, that's the one I need for my collection. Because it's got, you know, it's got boys and flowers and girliness. And so they're going to be like, I don't even know what to do with this. So we kind of geared that more towards fans. And that's why we kept in honorifics. We kept in a lot of the Japanese influences, like the whole three bowls of rice and all that stuff, moe. We kept that in because we knew that that was a fan favorite. Whereas something like Shin-chan or Panty and Stocking, stuff that somebody could feasibly go, I don't know what this is, but it looks funny and I'm going to watch it. Then that one, we don't leave those in because they're going to hear Chan or Kun and be like, what does that even mean? Right, Panty-chan. They're going to be like, what? I don't know. Yeah, like basically what happened is Gainax contacted Funimation. I can't talk. I'm a voice actor. Gynax contacted Funimation and said, we want you to make this as filthy as you can possibly make it within the realms of U.S. law. They also said, we want you to send back a list of all the curse words that you use and their definitions so that we can use them in Japan. Yeah, there was this whole thing where they were really into, like, they didn't want us to just take the translation and plug it in. Because there are a lot of things that are considered really foul in Japanese culture that don't, like foreskin. It's weird. It's weird to talk about it, right? But it's not something that we go, it's just a part of the anatomy. But to them, foreskin is a big deal. Right? And it's really funny and gross and you don't talk about it and I can't believe you said that word. So for Jamie, you know, it was like, I'm not going to say that. And then it's not enough to just say the F word because we're kind of like immune to it at this point. You know, you watch HBO and you're going to hear it like 8 times in an episode of any given show. So she kind of had to go a little bit farther. So that's why you'll hear a lot of the really blue humor and a lot of the really gross stuff is because she's trying to like have the same impact that it had in Japan. And that's what I tell people, like when you watch our dubs, they might not be verbatim exactly what is said in the Japanese, but the intent is this, that if you watch the show in English, and your friend watches the show in Japanese, that the two of you could sit together and have a conversation and feel the same way about the show, feel the same way about the characters, and that the message comes across. So that's our goal. They might use the word cute and we'll use the word adorable because there's 4 more flaps we have to fill. Or we might not be able to take what's actually being said verbatim. We'll have to take the intent of what's being said and make sure that that's conveyed for those reasons. So with Panty and Stocking, she couldn't use the actual translation because it didn't hit hard enough. It wouldn't have been funny enough. It wouldn't have had that shock value that it had. So, and I think that, you know, everybody who's like, well, the Japanese want it to be exactly like how they wrote it. Otherwise, they wouldn't even have bothered. And it's like, well, but they put our dub on their Blu-ray release. So I think that means they were happy with it. So let's all just be happy with it. So, I mean, it's hard to know sometimes where the line is and stuff, but with that one especially. And I mean, like the F word is actually animated into some of the scenes. So it's like it needs to be something that's going to hit people in the face repeatedly. And she did a very good job at doing that. Does anybody have any questions about script writing? Yeah. Oh, yeah.
If someone would say that they thought they were ready to be a writer, how would they get involved with Funimation or Sentai or like?
I wish I knew. Yeah. That's the only thing. I get the trainees, but I don't know how they got to be trainees. I don't know if it's a matter of writing Funimation or writing John Bergmeier and saying, hey, this is something I want to do. I know that there are people, for instance, Jeremy Kratz is not a voice actor, and he's a young adult author. He has many books published, and I don't know where he came from or how we found him, but he is brilliant, and I love him, and I'm so glad we did because he's so good at it. Same thing right now, I'm training some people that have nothing to do with voice acting. So I know that it's possible, I just have no idea. I would assume like if you can contact John Bergmeier, I don't think he's on Facebook. I don't know if he's on Twitter. I don't know how you would go about doing that, but if you could contact John Bergmeier, that'd probably be the best idea. Because I know that he does do test scripting throughout the year. I just don't know how to do any of that. Yeah, exactly. I only have his Funimation like writing email. Otherwise, I'd be like, hit him up. But yeah, that would probably be the best way, or to just contact Funimation and say, hey, I'm interested in this thing.
Like, one thing that you hear.
Oh, he does? John Bergmeier? Are you sure that's him? Oh, how am I not following my own boss?
Maybe that's a good thing.
Yeah, it might be a good thing. Because later on you'll see, Monica didn't turn her stuff in on time again. Oh. I've been working all weekend, John. Let me see. Let me make sure that's him. John Bergmeier. Sorry, guys. Oh, no.
Kind of like with the voice actors that they, in certain studios, have like the open casting call. Or
it is him. It is him. How did I not know he had a Twitter? Okay, he's on Twitter, at John Bergmeier. Yeah, making your anime talk good.
I'll have to look that up when I tell him. Thank you.
No problem. Okay, I'm going to tweet him real quick and be like, why didn't I know you have a Twitter? Oh, Andrew Love has one too.
So this is what Twitter is.
Well, I've been on Twitter forever. I know that Jay Hickman joined Twitter last night, and so he was like, hey, can you do me a favor? And I was like, yeah. And he goes, can you tell everybody that I'm on Twitter? I'm like, hell yeah, I can, because I like you. You're awesome. But I had no idea. He even follows me. I feel like an idiot. So yeah, that'd be a good way to contact him. But I do know that he does have test scripts that usually go out. Sometimes it's shows that have not been released yet. Usually it's shows that have not been released yet. And they do little sections of it to kind of test you on it. They used to do that. Like, they used to send out test scripts of stuff that had already been released, because the first thing that they would do is, like, throw out everybody who just wrote what was actually recorded, and they'd be like, and no. Which was a good test, because, you know, if you were just going to write down what was recorded, then on you. But yeah, it's hard, too. Those tests are hard, because I've had a lot of friends who I thought would have been really good at it take the test, and they're not what he's looking for some reason. So I don't even know what to tell you what to do to look for. It's a writing test. Like, usually Funimation, John will give a writing test at least, I think it's like once a year at least, where he'll have people write like a little segment of an anime to kind of test and see. And it's usually he picks like the hardest episodes that he can to kind of see how people deal with that. And if people kind of give up and throw their hands in the air, he's like, well, you weren't meant to do this. So there we go. But usually people are pretty good. Yeah, being local. Oh, I mean, I guess not really. We have people all over. Because Bonnie Klinkenbeard is a lead writer, and she lives in Austin. And then Jared Hedges and his team are out in LA. So it is possible to be, because we never, it'd be nice for people to come in and be able to see. Yeah, and to be able to see what we do if they're not actors, you know. But you certainly don't have to live in Dallas, you know. Clint Bickham is, I've worked with him for ages down at Sentai and ADB, and when he came to Funimation, like, that was a big deal. Now he's, like, the lead writer for One Piece. Like, he's got a huge deal on his plate. But, yeah, he's... Luckily, he speaks Japanese, too, so he's able to, like, he's a huge fan of One Piece, so that's been nice for them, because there's so much of it. Holy crap. Who else has a question? Hey.
Well, I know that last night you were talking about how, like, when you... Did you write the script for... Yeah, you said you wrote the script for Ghost Stories?
No, that was... We all made it up as we went along.
Oh, okay. Because I was, like, wondering, like, you said that doesn't happen, like, often, or it doesn't happen at all, and that was just...
It never happens that we completely improvise a show like that. Okay. Like, where we don't have a script, and you just kind of make stuff up as you go along. Like, it's usually so thought out, and everything is, like, scripted, and you have very particular things that you have to say. Okay. But that was the one time where they were like, let's just make it up as we go along. We'll just be funny as we go. So that never happens.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly. That's it. Like, that will never happen again, I don't think. Because, yeah, we're usually so... There's so much work that's put into it, and I think that's what people don't know. Like, I've had people come to me, and they're like, hey, I think I'd make a really great writer. And I'm like, I think you don't have enough time, because it's really time-consuming, and it's really... There's a lot of work that goes into every script. And so usually, you know, we don't take just a random translation and then don't even look at it and just make up whatever we want. But it sure was fun. I enjoyed it a lot. Yeah, exactly. Hey, hon.
Do you have any kind of specialized software that you use that helps you with creating scripts, or do you use basic Microsoft Word?
Microsoft Word. It's really, really basic. Yeah, we have a template that we use. It's in Microsoft Word, and that's why I can't show everybody, is because it's a very special secret template. And so, yeah, we use that, and then I use... It's like an old school movie player, media player that I love. No, it's not even Movie Maker. Like, it's really, really basic, and I love it because it's got a, I can hit control back or control forward, and it jumps 5 seconds back and forward, which is great when you're looking at lines over and over again. I can just go control back, control back, control back, and blip, blip, blip. So I don't even know what it's called, but it's like, you probably can't even get it anymore because it's so old, and my PC is from, like, 2007. It's hanging on by a prayer. Like, it's literally like, help me. Please get a new computer. So, yeah, yeah. I couldn't even download Windows 10 because my computer is so old. I tried, and it was like, and no. So, yeah, I have to get a new one. But I'm trying to bide my time as long as I can because computers are expensive. And also because everybody's trying to get me to get a Mac. I like my PC. Thank you. Thank you. I have an iPhone, and I love my iPhone, but I like my PC because it's so easy to use. That's the thing is I know people that have spent like $2,000 to $3,000 on a computer, and then it dies in like 3 years. My computer has lasted me since 2007, and it's still going. Barely, but it's going. It's still there. It's still kicking. Hi, y'all all look so cute. Hi, Karuta. All right, what's up, Taj?
Hello.
Hello.
Now, you recently worked on Yoda of the Dawn.
Yes.
As well as being descripted after.
Yes.
Can you talk about what it was like working on that?
Yoda of the Dawn was a weirdin', because we started in the middle. There were two shows that right before we started doing these broadcast dubs regularly, Funimation had gotten the licenses for. But unfortunately, at the time we got it, they were like, okay, well, here's the deal. We want the second season to be broadcast dubbed. Like, because that was... The Japanese companies are allowed to make that decision. So they decided, hey, Yona of the Dawn 13 through 24, 26, I can't remember. 13 through whatever is going to be a broadcast dub. And we were like, okay, what do we do about 1 through 13? At least with Tokyo Ghoul, I had enough of a heads up where I was able to write. We were able to get all of 1 through 12 out before Route A started, really. With Yona, that was not the case. So I had to watch all of Yona. Repeatedly, actually. Yes. Yes, because her, yeah. And it's a great, it's a beautiful, beautiful show. It's kind of set in Korea.
Yeah, so, the alternate version of Korea.
Yeah, and it's really, really gorgeous. But because of them wanting to broadcast dub the second season, I had to start from episode 13 and write 13 on and then go back and write 1 through 12. It's also the way we recorded it. That's why you see a cast that's me and Sabat and Ian and Eric Vale, because Colleen Klinkenbeard basically went, who can I cast that can pick up in the middle of a show, finish it, and then go back and make it right back to where they started? Because, you know, we wanted to make sure that when you guys watch it all together, that it's not like, oh, you can definitely tell where they picked up and where they didn't. So yeah, it was a challenge as a writer because you're coming in at a place where and it's not one of those series where like Tokyo Ghoul where there was kind of an end and then it picked up. It just, we literally ended in one episode and the next episode was just the next moment. And so we picked up at that next moment and kept going. So it was very difficult. It was very challenging. And as an actor, especially so, but Colleen was like, when she asked me, she goes, I know you're really busy right now and you're working on a lot of stuff, but I would really like for you to play Princess Yona. And I was like, I would love to play Princess Yona. I think she's fabulous. She goes, well, I think you'll be great at it, but even more than that, you know what's going on. She's like, I'm not going to hire some actress and be like, hey, can you watch this show a few times? Because we're going to start in the middle and then finish it and then go back from the beginning. So it was tough, but it's such a good show. And Clifford Chapin ended up taking over directing for Colleen, and he did a really great job with it. So it's a fun one.
Well, I have another one for you.
Sure.
Now, you also worked on Tokyo Ghoul Route A.
Yes.
Can you talk a little more about that if you can?
I can. I just don't want to give away any spoilers or anything. But we did Route A. We actually wrote 1 through 12 first and then did Route A. And so It was hard because you don't have all of that information. You would think with broadcast dubs and stuff that like the Japanese would say, hey, here's a list of characters. Here's kind of a timeline of what's going to happen just so you have an idea. Yeah, that doesn't happen. So literally you can kind of watch the simulcast, which is a couple of episodes ahead to kind of find out what's happening, but you still don't really know. So there was one line in particular, you know, this is one of those instances where when people are like, oh, I bet you they just crap out those scripts. I'm like, okay, there was one line in Tokyo Ghoul Rude that we weren't quite sure about. And so I called Sarah, who is the head translator at Funimation. I'm like, do you have any idea what this means? She's like, not really. She's like, it could mean this, it could mean that, it could just be them talking philosophically, we don't know. I was like, okay, well, I don't have the liberty of time, so I'm going to sit there and look at the line. And so I spent 2.5 hours on the phone with John Bergmeier, and we looked at every option for one line. It was an Ayato line that Todd Haberkorn ended up saying, and it went by so quick, and I couldn't believe it. I was like, I spent 2.5 hours. Dude, I kind of wanted to just go, Todd, you're going to have to say that line like 3,800 times to make up for the work that I did. But it was one of those things where it's like, you know, if I could express to people, you know, people bitch about dubs all the time and they're like, oh, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, if you knew how much work, especially on the script writing side, is put into it, you would probably like bite your tongue a little bit because we put so much effort into it. And then again, there's also things that happen like you write your best script ever, but then it goes into the booth and the director might decide that he wants to take a totally different view with it and just changes all your stuff and there's nothing you can do. And your name's still attached. It's the worst part. And that's the hardest thing to teach new writers is like, hey, I know this is your baby. I know you spent a lot of time on it. You lost some hair, maybe drank a little to kind of ease the pain. But once you're done and you turn it in, it's not yours anymore. It has your name on it, but it's not yours. Because what happens is once it goes to the booth, people talk at different paces. Things have to be changed for flaps. Sometimes we're writing to broadcast a video and then we get the final video and all of a sudden there's pauses where there weren't pauses. So it's kind of a work in progress, if you will. But for a lot of writers, it's really hard to let go of that. And they're like, why are you changing my stuff? Don't change my stuff. It's like, well, everybody chill out. So yeah, it's hard. Huh? Exactly. That's been the issue is there's been times where I'll mark in scripts, like in the side, we have a little section for notes and I'm like, don't you dare change this. This is why I did it. Like, this is going to come back as a flashback 32 episodes later. Don't change it. Especially with Fairy Tale. That's the one where I was like, this is a licensor term. Whether you like it or not, you cannot change it. Like, okay. And like exclamation points and red and underlining and like, do not change it. And usually I try to be real careful about that kind of stuff because there are, like in shows that are long running like that, there'll be one character that comes in and goes, hey, how are you? Remember me? Ha! And then 36 episodes later, guess what we flash back to? Hey, you, remember me? But it's going to be different animation. The worst part was the boatman. Every time Lucy's walking along the water and there's a guy that's like, don't fall in. Ah, you're back. And then sometimes it's a different boat guy, but you're like, is that supposed to be the same boat guy? They just forgot what color they colored his shirt. Maybe he grew a beard and I didn't know. And so there's this whole, like, so you sit there and I write notes like, excuse me, Tyler, but this is the boat guy from episode blah, but he looks different. So it could be a totally different boat guy, but I think it's the same boat guy. And here's why. Yeah. And everybody's like, why'd you take a break from Fairy Tale? Although I took a break from Fairy Tale and I got Yona of the Dawn and Tokyo Ghoul. Hey, just pick up in the middle. You'll be fine. I'm like, So yeah, I always get the shows where they're like, hey, you need to do a bunch of research. You need to know a bunch of characters. Or, yeah, that's me. Well, thank you, Taj.
Biggie.
What's your question, sir?
Afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My question is, how hard is it when you have to both write the script for the show and you have to play the lead?
It actually actually is much easier, believe it or not, because you wrote the words. So it's a lot easier to say the things that you... I will say that it helps when I know, like, it's a character I'm going to play, like, for writing for Fairy Tale. Mira Jane's stuff was so easy to write, because I'm like, I'm just going to say it how I would say it, and write it in there. So it was awesome. It's also awesome when you get to audition for a show that you've written for, because it's like, oh, I know where this is going. Excuse me as I rock this audition like no one else will. And then sometimes, you know, you get to have a little bit of feedback or input. So like with Rize, I absolutely loved Rize, and I kind of was like, so Mike, I kind of want it. And he goes, oh, I was just going to cast you as Rize. I'm like, yeah. But all of that comes from, you know, writing it. With Yona, because I knew I was going to be playing Yona, because I knew we were picking up in the middle, it made it that much easier, I guess, to write it and to adapt it. And also because I knew, okay, Chris Sabat is going to be Hawk, and Ian Sinclair is going to be, and Josh Greeley. So I knew who was going to be in the cast, so I could write it with them in mind. And I find that a lot of writers, it helps to have somebody in mind. Even if those people don't end up playing those roles, at least you can kind of hear them. Now, whenever I write for Natsu, it's like Todd Haberkorn is just in my head. You know what I mean? Like, I can't even imagine writing without that. A good example is, has anybody seen Control for the Power of Money and it's got a really long title.
I know of the show. I haven't gotten
to see. Well, it's a great show, and I got to work on that one. And there was a character, and I can't remember the character's name right now, but all I could think of was J. Michael Tatum. I was like, if this isn't J. Michael Tatum... Same thing with Tsukiyama in Tokyo Ghoul. I was like, if this isn't J. Michael Tatum, there's something wrong with this world. So I would write the character for J. Michael Tatum, and in both cases, he ended up playing it, which was awesome, but that doesn't always end up that way.
Yeah, I was just curious because Michael said when he was working on Steins Gate that it could get really hard work writing and being the lead.
I think for him, that's Steins Gate. I wouldn't want to touch that with a 10-foot pole.
I see.
That's a lot of work. That show was very tricky and very intricate. And so, yeah, I could see. I had a hard time writing and directing, because then you're just constantly living in that show. And with those people, like I directed and wrote Kenichi, the Mightiest Disciple, at the same time. That's a lot of any one show. So that was rough. But actually portraying the character doesn't bother me as much. But I'm not working on Steins Gate. Thank God. It's very complex. Yes?
Has there ever been a show that you've written the script for and just look at it and go, like, it just sticks with you for a long time?
You mean like as in touching, or like it really ruined me, or?
Or there were like certain moments that like either comedic moments or dramatic moments that it's like, okay, this one, I remember exactly what I wrote for this line. And
it's hard to remember anything I wrote just because, you know, there's words traveling through my head every day with voice acting and stuff. But there are certainly moments, you know, like where you go, okay, that was good. I did good on that. And there are certain moments where you go, that's as good as it's going to get. Moving on, you know, because you can't spend, I mean, other than Tokyo Ghoul, you shouldn't spend 2.5 hours on one line. But usually I try to move pretty quickly. But yeah, there are certainly moments where I've had eureka moments, or there's moments that I'm proud of, or like I created a document when I first worked on Sacred Blacksmith and adapting those scripts. And my character in that show is always coming up with euphemisms for boobs for Sheremy's character. And so I created this list of different names for boobs. And it's like a 3-page list. And I have used that list and I've passed it along to all the other writers, because we've all had shows where we've had to talk about, you know, smuggling midgets in your sweater, or, you know, melanators, or whatever you want to call them. So there's proud moments like that where I can go, oh, are you writing the next booby show? This might help you out. You know, or trying to come up with terms for beating people up that aren't, that don't have any foul language. Because there's a lot of shows like Kenichi where people have to beat each other up and you can't say foul language because it's meant for a younger audience. So I have lists. That's why I get all the hard shows, is I create these lists and documents and then I share them. So yeah, my booby document is my favorite though. Very proud of that. Yeah, right. I would, but then my secret would be out. Yes.
All right, I have a very unique one for you.
Oh, good.
All right, now, you were heavily involved in Nabari no O.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And you were also involved in Seron Kagura, too.
Two very different shows.
Yeah, can you tell me where it's like working on them and how different they were for you?
Well, Nabari no O was gay ninjas. And Seron Kagura was pretty much... Pretty much. Oh my god, so maybe they are more in common than I thought.
Yeah, so basically you worked on a yaoi title and a yuri title.
Yes. How funny. I didn't even think about that. Nabari had a much more solemn tone to it. It was very, very... it's a great show if you guys haven't seen Nabari no O. And as a director, it was the first show that I got to... work on from the bottom up. Like, I didn't have anybody giving me any casting input or anything. I cast the show all by myself, and I felt really, really proud of that. I think there were some great performances by Brina and Tatum and Joel McDonald. It's one of the first things that he did, and he was really great. And then Senran was fun for the totally opposite reasons, because it was so goofy. And I think what happens is a lot of the writers and actors at Funimation kind of don't want to do the kind of ecchi shows because they're like, ew, that's gross. To me, as long as it has a sense of humor and it kind of laughs at itself, then it's okay. So like Senran, we kind of took the humor level to a higher level. We were like, okay, so the narrator in the original is just like, this is what's happening on Senran Kagura. And we're like, wouldn't it be a little cooler if maybe he was a perv? And like, these girls are flying through the air and their panties are showing and their boobs are falling out. So wouldn't it be kind of funny if he's kind of into that? And so I passed it by John and I was like, he goes, yeah, I mean, you can have fun with it. Now, don't piss off the licensor of the games. So you still have to check everything. But yeah, you can have fun with it. So we did. We did it kind of tongue in cheek. So it was kind of poking fun at itself. Because if anybody's seen it, like, they get these crazy sushi rolls, right? That looked like a giant Chipotle burrito. And of course, instead of cutting it apart and eating them all delicately, they put the whole thing in their mouth. Even the male teacher. So it's all very tongue-in-cheek and very silly and goofy. So instead of taking it seriously, we kind of went over the top with it and made it a joke in and of itself. And that kind of lightened the mood. So yeah, they were two totally different shows, but to work on them as an adapter and an actor, it was a lot of fun. A funny thing about Senran is... I had Chris George, who is a director, but also an engineer. He came up to me one day and he's like, so of all the girls in Senran, like, if you got to play one, like, which one would you want to play? And I was like, I'd like to do something different. I was like, I like Homura. I think she's cool. She's kick-ass, and I don't ever get to play those kinds of characters.
Yeah, and ironically, you ended up playing Homura.
Well, and I think that's what happened is Chris George went over to Jerry Jewell and went, Monica wants to play Homura. And then I got cast. I was like, sweet. I'm just going to go up to Jerry all the time and be like, I want to play this character. And then with Cruel, he cast me as Cruel Tepish and Seraph of the End. But I think that was kind of an inside joke because I played Mina Tepish. And they're like, why don't you just be queen of all the vampires? Woo. I'll take it. But yeah, those two shows were a lot of fun. A lot of gay ninjas. It was awesome.
Good answer. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, Anne-Marie.
I actually have two questions.
Sure, go for it.
For the first one, do you ever like have an opportunity to actually pick what show you would want to write a script for, or are they just given to you?
It's usually given to you. The only time I ever got to pick was with Tokyo Ghoul, because John came to me and was like, okay, so, you know, you wanted to take a break from Fairy Tail, so we're not going to move you on to something else. I have these two shows. I have Tokyo Ghoul and I have Dragonar Academy. Yeah. And I went, okay. And I was like, okay, let me do a little Google search real quick. And I did a little Google search, and within 5 seconds, I was like, Tokyo Ghoul. And he's like, I figured you would say that, but I just wanted to give you the option. So yeah, that was one of those where I got to choose, but usually it's given to you. I was lucky to get Fairy Tail because we had a show that shall not be named that was very long running and ended up losing that title. So we had started working on it. I had my team. We were like, woo! And then it went away and I was crushed. Not because I really was attached to the title so much as I was like, years and years of work gone. And so I think John felt like, here's Fairy Tail. if it does well, it could be years and years of work. And sure enough, it's done really well, so that's good. And I absolutely love Fairy Tale and was glad to be the lead writer of that for such a long time. Yeah. But yeah, and usually we don't get to pick. Usually they're given to us.
And my second question was that you were saying that like when you write the scripts that like sometimes you have like voice actors in mind, or like you're like saying like, oh, this is like a character that I would like to play and stuff like that. Like, is that like, I don't want to say aloud because obviously it's happened.
Right.
But if someone like writes the script for an anime, like, are they like able to like say, hey, I think, could I like audition?
You can this? Certainly. I mean, that's the thing is, if you're a writer, you can certainly say like, hey, I'd be really interested. And as an actor, like if there's a show that comes through and you're interested in it, you can certainly say, excuse me, director, sir, or madam, I'm really interested in auditioning for this character. Whether that means you will actually get to, or they might have somebody else in mind, you never know. But yeah, usually you're allowed to say that. You just don't want to be that person that like shows up with flowers and candy is like, I want to play that character, please. You don't want to be that guy. But yeah, you can certainly say, I want to audition for this if given the opportunity. Okay. Yeah, that's considered perfectly okay.
So even like writers, like, because you were saying that there are some writers that they've never done voice acting, but they just do like script writing. But like if they get like that one script where they're just like, I've never done voice acting before, but.
I don't think any of them want to. That's the difference, is that like the writers that we have that aren't voice actors, the few that I've seen that have come into the booth are like, I don't want to do that. That looks like no fun to me. And then the ones like, yeah, Bonnie Klinkenbeard is Colleen's sister, and so she's been down and watched us, and she's like, oh, hell no. You guys have fun with all of that. But if they wanted to, I'm sure that they could, but then it would be even more difficult because they'd have to actually get an audition. They'd have to make sure that they could actually act before they did it. Okay. Cute. Hi.
Question.
Yes.
I don't know how much you're into or how much time you have to watch anime that's not dubbed.
Not much. I don't have much time to watch anything these days. I'm so far behind on Orphan Black, I want to cry.
Oh, okay. So I was going to ask if there was something out there that hasn't been or that has a manga that isn't dubbed or anything like that or hasn't even been talked about having, if there's like something that you want to work on that you're like, oh, I want to be that character.
I used to do that. Like, that's how I ended up working at Funimation. Is New Type magazine is an awesome magazine. I wrote for them for a while. But early on, I would get New Types and look through all the stuff that was in Japan that we didn't have. Now, granted, back then it took like 2 years for stuff to come over from Japan. So you had a lot more time to look at things and learn about the story than you do now. I'd seen the art for Kitty Grade and I'd fallen in love with Lumiere, and I was like, oh God, I really want to be in the show. And so ADB had such a good relationship with Studio Gonzo at the time. I was like, surely ADB's going to get it. Yeah, I'm totally going to be, it's going to be great. I'll audition for it. It's going to be awesome. And then Funimation got it. And I was actually at A-Con with Mike McFarland when they announced that Funimation had gotten it. And I was like, Funimation doesn't do anime. They do Dragon Ball and Yu Yu Hakusho. What is this? They do that? I mean, they do anime, but they don't do anime. Like, we were doing, like, the hardcore stuff. And Mike McFarland said, well, you know, would you be interested in coming to Dallas to work on the show? I was like, yeah. Yeah, I'd totally drive 4 hours to go work on the show. And, like, months later, like 6 months later, I got a call from a girl named Tara. And she's like, I need to schedule you for 8 hours. And I was like, for what? And she's like, oh, I'm sorry, you've been cast as Lumiere in Kitty Grade at Funimation. I was like,
and you didn't even audition?
Well, what happened was Mike McFarland went back to Funimation and went, hey, I met this voice actress from Houston. She really wants to be in Kitty Grade. Here's Excel Saga. She was in this show. She is the dying princess. Watch Excel Saga. So Justin Cook watched Excel Saga and cast me as Lumiere off of Excel Saga. So when I went in to record for Justin the first time, and I was like, hello, Mr. Cook, my name is Monica Rial. And he looked at me and he goes, oh my God, that's really your voice. Yep. And that began my friendship with Justin Cook. I try not to do it as much because I'm always so worried that I'm going to find the one show that we don't get. Or, you know, like I would have loved to have been a part of Sailor Moon, but I didn't want to get my hopes up. And then it went out to LA, which, I mean, if I really wanted to, I guess I could audition for LA shows, but that's so far. It's not like Houston where it's like, oh, I can drive 4 hours. That's like buy a plane ticket and fly and then drive in LA traffic and no. So I try not to spend too much time. Now, there's stuff that's been announced. Like, they just announced Full Metal Panic, a new season. I'll be damned if I'm not in that. If Kyoko's in that, I want to be in that. And I will find, I don't care if it is LA or Canada, I will find that studio. And I will be Kyoko again. So, yeah, but I try not to look at too much stuff. Now, I do listen to what you guys say. So, if, like, you guys tweet me and say, hey, you'd be really great at this character or you'd be really great at that character, then I tend to pay more attention. So, when those auditions come up. So, like, for Watamote, people have been telling me for months. They're like, oh, my God, you would be so good as this character, Tomoko. And I didn't even audition for that. That was the weirdest one. They just called me out of the blue and were like, nobody else can do this. And I was like, okay. And I got in there and I was like, I think that might have been an insult. It's like a backhanded compliment. Like, nobody else can be insane. Can you come be insane? But yeah, so I do listen to when you guys are like, hey, in this show, there's this character you should look for. Because that helps me. Because I usually go in blind. And even now, like these days and times, it's harder because we don't have a lot of time to audition because of the broadcast stubs. So a lot of times that I just get cast. And then I walk in totally blind. Like, I have no idea what I'm doing today. Like, for Gangsta, I walked in and I had been the baby. Like, I play a little baby Luis who cries in the background. So I've done that. So, you know, it's me going into Bevins's booth and maybe, like, as a hooker and then doing baby noises or whatever. And then I thought that's what I was going to be doing. I'm like, why does he have me for an hour and a half to cry like a baby? And then I walk in, he's like, oh, okay, so no, you're going to be playing this character. And he puts her on screen and I went, ho, 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 ho. This isn't a baby. This isn't a hooker. Well, questionable. So you just never know. Like, you never know from week to week what you're going to be doing. Going in for Bevins again, for Yuri Kuma Arashi. I knew that we had the show. I knew that it was from the same creators as Penguin Drum, but I had really no idea what was going on. So the new broadcast dub stuff has been interesting because we don't have as much time to do research and stuff, so we just kind of go in. But yeah, if you guys ever see anything and you're like, hey, you should really look at this show or you should really, you know, try for this character, then let me know. Tweet me. Tweet me. You're welcome, Steve. Hello.
My question goes back to the script writing. When you're writing a script, oh yeah, we get to play this cameo.
That's what you get for being tall.
Not my fault. when you're writing the actual script for a character to read, mm-hmm. do you write it with the other characters in line, like in the script, so they're reading from the script that has like character A, B, and C, and they're only reading the B lines, or is it just all the lines with like the scenes that happen that don't involve them in between, so they can get into the mood?
Oh yeah, it's written like a play, basically. Okay. So it's written just from beginning to end. So what the director will do is skip time codes to go to the character, but that way you have the line before you and the line after you. I have some new writers who have come over from video game adapting. And it's hard to teach them because when you work on video games, you very much go line by line. It's like, okay, this is your line, this is your line, this is your line. And it's not a conversation. So explaining to them that, like, hey, you need to do each line, but they need to flow. It needs to be one whole thought. So yeah, we do it that way so that the actor has the liberty of reading everything that came before their line and then delivering it. Because sometimes... And that's a mistake that a lot of new voice actors make, is that they don't read the line before and the line after. So they kind of go, this is the read I should do. And then you're like, oh, but no, that guy just asked you a question. And that's why you're responding. Oh, that's totally different. So yeah, we try to keep it all in there so that they have that context.
And the other question was, when you were saying it goes like from Japanese to English, it's statement, statement, statement. And mm-hmm. then you turn it into a question, response, follow-up question, and then like excited response or something. How easily is it able to flow for most shows, at least? Like, because I know a harder, more
right.
said four-syllable words and Scrabble words is going to be a lot harder if you need to cover them the flaps,
right.
reactions.
Most shows, it's actually pretty easy because when you take into account that we're taking out all the names, so like, you know, the whole, hey, your name, my name, then that leaves you with a little bit of a buffer. So you have a little bit more space to play with. The problem that I have with a lot of writers, or that I have to beat out of a lot of writers, is they'll go, okay, my translation is like this long, but I need this much words. I need this many words. So what they'll do is they'll fill with what I call flap filler. So there'll be a lot of really, but, just, I mean, you know. And I'm like, hey, I can see through that so clearly. You need to make like a full sentence. It needs to not have any of that stuff in there. But yeah, it can get really tricky, but it's actually pretty easy to make it sound like a conversation. You just have to be able to. One of the best things that I can do as an editor is when I'm done with a script or when somebody turns in a script, one of the first things I do is don't even look at the video. I read it as like a play to make sure that it sounds like it's people talking to one another. Right. And then I'll highlight anything that seems weird and I'll go back and check with the video. And usually sometimes it'll be like, oh, that was a scene break I didn't realize. Or, oh, they're talking to this person I didn't realize. But usually 9 times out of 10, if it's weird when you just read it through, then it's weird in the actual mix. So.
Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Hello.
Hello. Okay. Now I have 2 more questions for you.
Sure.
Now, first off, you worked on Space Dandy.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is what I've been dying to ask you. What was it like working on that one?
Space Dandy was crazy. Okay, how many people have seen Space Dandy? Pretty much everybody, kind of, sort of. Oh, no, it was really good. So we knew that Space Dandy was a test. We just didn't know what kind of test it was going to be. Basically, we were told, hey, there's this show coming, and it's going to be really, really, really tight because we're doing a simultaneous release in Japan and the United States. Technically, it premiered in the United States before it premiered in Japan, but simultaneous. So what ended up happening is John created like a dream team, if you will. It was me and Jamie and Patrick Seitz and Bonnie Klinkenbeard, all people that have been working for him for a long time. He's like, all right, you four have a similar style. You're my go-to team. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to get a translate. We're going to get the video. It's going to be translated in 2 days. Then you're going to write it in 2 days.
Jesus.
Yeah, we normally get a week to 2 weeks to write one script. 2 days. Sometimes it wasn't even a whole full day. For one episode. But that's 24 minutes of dialogue. 2 days, and it's gotta be funny. And not just like, ha ha, funny, but like, ha, funny. So we were all like, holy crap, holy crap, holy crap. Then, like I said before, the Japanese aren't always very good about giving you information. So we knew that there was Dandy, and Meow, and QT, and Scarlet, and Honey. I think those were the 5 characters that they were like, here's your cast. We knew the name of the ship, and we had a picture of the ship. That's it. They didn't tell us what the show was about. They didn't tell us if it was going to be episodic or not. They didn't tell us anything. So it was literally kind of going, we were learning about the show as we went along. Another thing is because it was a simultaneous release, sometimes we didn't have finished video. I didn't see the opening to Space Dandy until like episode 15. Because they were still animating it.
Whoa. So basically, you guys are pretty much going in blind or in the basic info.
It's the closest that I will ever get to working on the Japanese side of things. Because I was literally, like, when their dub script writers were getting it, I was getting it. So me and whoever was writing the episodes in Japan were having the same struggle at the same time, going, holy crap, what did you just do to me? And how am I going to make this funny? So, and then we went out of order, too, because the way that they animated each episode, some took longer than others. So, like, I did I forget which episode number it is, but the whole Tondra Volta episode where there's a lot of singing and music. That was the last episode we recorded and wrote because it took them so long to animate that. So the whole show was done. Monica waited 2 weeks, like, where's my episode? Cartoon Network was like, where's that episode? And finally it came and I was like, ah, and turn it in and record it real fast. So, but I will say that Space Dandy for me was a huge lesson because as a writer and as an actor, as a human being, you tend to question, you know, what you put out. It's like, okay, was that good enough? Well, let me rethink that. I'm going to second guess myself and change this line. I don't think that's funny. Let me change this. I didn't have time to do that on Space Dandy. So I literally was like, here's what I think is funny. If you don't think that's funny, here are 3 other things that I think are funny. You decide. And so at first I was like, oh my God, I hope it's funny, I hope it's funny. And my first episode to come out was the zombie episode. And when everybody was like, holy crap, that was funny, I'm like, oh, thank God. Oh, thank God. Because, yeah, there was a moment of, I don't even know what I'm doing. I hope this is all right. But it was a great show, and I loved writing for it. And even though it was so stressful, I mean, there were tears. There were tears. There were times Jamie and I would call each other and be like, I hate this. And then 2 days later, I love this. So it was like, it was hard. But at the same time, it's an experience that I'm very happy to have had. It's a great show. If you haven't seen it, Space Dandy is a lot of fun, and it's not episodic. It's episodic, so you can watch episodes out of order. It's totally fun. Yeah, it's cute.
Nice. All right, and here's my final question
sure.
to you. Now, not counting Space Dandy, what was probably your most favorite title to work on as a script adapter, and what was also your most difficult one?
Some of my favorites, Oron was one of my favorites. I worked under a pseudonym because I didn't want people to hate me if they hated it, but luckily they don't, so yay, I'm Dorothy Garrett. So that one was fun, and gosh, what else? And I also got to train Tatum on that one. I actually trained Michael J. Tatum. J. Michael Tatum. He's one of my best friends. He's going to kill me. Don't tell him that. Yeah, he's totally on Twitter. I know that. We used to live next door to each other. I know that. So, yeah, I loved Oron. Tokyo Ghoul was great. Yona was great, even though it was challenging. Most of the stuff I've done, I've really liked. And I loved working on Underwater Re Romano. Utawate Romano. But that was really difficult. And the reason it was so difficult is because it was otherworldly. So I don't know if any of you have seen Utawari, but it's about a species that's human-ish, but not quite human, and it's set in a world that's like ours, but not really ours. So there's things that you couldn't say that you wouldn't think about. Like, they can't say, we're going to do this for the people, because are they people? They're not really people. You know what I mean? So you couldn't like refer to people or person or God or any of these things that we so quickly refer to, because none of those things necessarily applied in their world. And that was really difficult.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Hello.
Hi. This one's not script related.
That's fine.
With Sky Wizards Academy, when you took over as Melody for the second half of the show, that's going to be re-recorded, right, for the DVDs with...
Yes.
Still going to get, like, some sort of credit in there?
Probably not, but that's totally okay. So Sky Wizards Academy is one of the broadcast dubs, and I'm the editor for it. Jeremy Kratz wrote the show, but I edited all the scripts, so I've seen the whole show. So what happened was the actress Meg Shipman, who plays Lecty, something came up. She had to go do some surgery. She's totally fine. Everything's okay, but she had to go be out for a while. So they came to me and they're like, hey, would you mind stepping in for Meg for the broadcast dub? And I was like, oh, okay, sure. And what that means is that because she couldn't be there weekly because she was, you know, getting better, I would go in weekly and do the part because I had already seen all of the show and I knew the character very well. And then what'll happen is she's going back to record it so that on the DVD release, it will actually be her voice throughout. It was just one of those things like when we started with the broadcast dubs, we knew that that might be an issue. Yeah, because people get sick, they go out of town, whatever. So we were told very early on, like, hey, if you're not around, we might have to voice match you for a week or whatever. Most of us are very territorial and are like, don't you dare. I will come in and do my stuff. But in this situation, she couldn't be. And Meg is a sweetheart, and I was happy to help them out. And I got to work with Felicia, who I've never worked with as a director, so that was a lot of fun. Hello.
Well, the first thing is you talked about the new phone model actually used. I had just told my friend about it, and he was like, if Sentai doesn't dub this show, I'm not watching it.
About which one?
Full Metal Panic.
Oh, the new, yeah.
The first thing you said when I told him, like, if Sentai doesn't dub this show, not watching.
Well, and that's where it's tricky because it was done for ADV, but then we did it at season at Funimation through ADV.
Yeah.
But then ADV doesn't have... But yeah, Funimation has the license now. But then I don't know what's going to happen with it. So it's like a weirdness. I hope.
I just thought it was a funny statement. Because it's a dub that has aged really well over the years. It's still really
It's a cute dub.
Mm-hmm.
I like it.
But for my actual question was, Have you ever been? Have you ever like worked with another script writer? And sometimes you're in there, and you might give them pointers when you read their scripts, or.
Oh yeah, I'm a trainer. So basically, Jamie Markey and I are the two like trainers at Funimation. So like, if you're hired on as a new writer, you will be put with either her or I, or sometimes both of us, back and forth, so that we can beat you down. And then hopefully build you back up. And so it's our job, and we go through a process. It's like the first time I edit your scripts, I will make all the changes, and I will mark things out, and I will write things in red to correct, and then I'll write you a big, long monologue on each one saying, this is why I had to change it. This is why this is better. If you don't understand, send me an email with this line and a question mark. And I do that in fact, I'm doing one right now, and I've been working on it all weekend, because that's what you do. Is like when people first start out, they don't know. So instead of like going, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, you go, this is wrong. Let me explain why this is wrong. Here are some options that would have worked better. Little things that you wouldn't think about. Like when the flaps of a character are like, ba-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-ba. That better be a vowel at the end, or there are going to be directors that want your hide. Because a T sound on an open mouth just doesn't work very well. But those are things you don't think about as a writer. You're like, hey, it makes sense, characters, blah, blah, blah. So I have to go through and teach them all of that. Then as we go along, like say on their third or fourth script, then I start highlighting things. Hey, this doesn't work. It's short, it's long, this is why. And then as we go along, the less notes I give, I'll just start highlighting stuff in the hopes that people will figure out, oh, okay, I get why this didn't work. And then there's the whole formatting side of things. Like you've got time codes, you've got reactions. Sometimes time coders or people aren't very good about understanding when something is an actual reaction and when it's a say you taking a breath to say a line. Because sometimes you'll hear the say you breathe and they're like, la 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 la. That's not a reaction, that's just somebody breathing. Whereas if they go, bah! Blah, 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 blah. That's a reaction that needs to be marked. But so it's teaching them all those little nuances and things. And it's a very time-consuming process. And like I have a writer right now that I'm training, and she's brilliant, but she's also very pregnant. And so I send her these scripts that are all marked up in red, and like it looks like blood. And she's like, I'm a horrible writer. I suck. My life is not worthy. And I'm like, you are so good. Here's the thing. I wouldn't give you all those notes if I thought you were bad. Because if I thought you were bad, I would just go to John and go, because I've had to do that before. Because some people just don't get it. You give them a shot. You give them a couple of shots. And then if they still don't get it, it's like, I can't waste, you know, 20 hours of my life on you. I'm sorry. There are other people that could probably pick it up. But with her, she's really, really good. And I try to convey to her that, like, hey, the reason I give you all these notes is because you're really good and you're going to be awesome. Please don't cry. But she's about to have a baby. So I'm like, once you pop that baby out, girl, we'll talk. So we'll be good. Thank you. Yes. It's by the script. I can't tell you how much, of course, because contract obligations, whatever. But usually you're paid by the script. In my situation, it's a little different because if I'm training you, I get part of your money because it took a lot of my time to fix your script, basically. And then once you are your own writer, you get all of the money. And then I just fix what you've, you know, any little typos or mistakes that you might have. It just depends on what rank you are and like where you fall into that. Writers are all paid the same amount, so it doesn't matter if you're a brand new writer just out of training or a writer that's been doing it for 30 years. You're all paid the same amount. So, and it's decent. It's pretty good. I think it's really good, actually. Yes. No, we're in Texas. It's a right-to-work state. I mean, it's great, but at the same time, it sucks because we don't get any residuals, which means that we get a lot of work really fat. Like, I'm constantly working, but I don't ever, like, I'm paid one flat rate, and then that's all I see of it. which is fine with me, but I know in LA they're real big on the unions and stuff. We just don't have that luxury. We don't have unions. And in Houston and well, in Texas, it actually works against you to be a part of the union, because a lot of times people will have like one union contract in a show of like 50 performers. So you better hope that you're the best person in town to get that one contract, because otherwise you have to set it out. So, you know, that's why I never did Actors Equity when I was in theater. I was like, there's like two contracts for this whole entire show. I don't want to be up against the two 50-year-old men they flew in from New York who are definitely getting those contracts. There's no way I'm going to get one. So no residuals, but that's okay. How much time do we have? Am I good or? 5 minutes. Anybody else have questions? Yes. Yeah, oh, you can definitely play with words, but it also depends on who your actor is. So, like, you have to give what we call alts. So you'll have, like, a line that I would give that has, like, a vowel ending, let's say. And then on the next one, I might say, wah, and hold the wah. Or, you know, I'll give, maybe turn it into a reaction on one alternate line and be like, I want you to say the line and then go, you know, something like that, and see. Because you don't know, usually if you're starting to write a script, you don't know who's going to play the role. You don't know what's going on. So it's better to be safe than sorry. So I teach people to like leave a lot of alternates. That way there's options for the director. And then there are some directors that don't care if a big open flap stops on a consonant. But then there are others that really do. So you kind of have to like weave in between. So I try to like always give. Funimation is super anal. And I mean, that's good, because nobody ever complains about the flap work at Funimation. If you did, you'd be insane, because we spend way too much time. But then you'd look at stuff, like especially the early Sentai stuff, people are like, oh my God, the flap work is terrible. And I'm like, well, yeah, because we were trying to get it out really fast. And on some of those early shows, we didn't even have writers. We literally took the translation and kind of adapted as we were working. So it's amazing that they turned out as good as they did, really, because we didn't even have script writers. So now everything is scripted, and they're paying much more attention to flaps than they used to. Who else has a question? Yes. I like the waving.
Is there like an anime that she wish you wrote the script for?
Not really. I like writing. I can't think of any. I mean, like, there were a couple of Space Dandy episodes. I think I got the best ones, but there were a couple that I was like, oh, I would have liked to have done that one too. I'm glad I didn't get the one with the dog and the sad one. That was Jamie. I was like, I'm sorry, Jamie. She goes, that wasn't funny at all. She's like, I didn't like that at all. That was bad. So yeah, I'm glad I didn't get that. But no, I wish I had gotten the chance to work on Shin-Chan. That was the group that was out of LA. Those scripts were funny because they would give you three alts. The first one would be like, you can say this on television. The second one would be like, you probably can't say this on television, but maybe you can. And the third one would be like, you definitely can't say this on television, but we want to hear you say it anyway. So yeah, those were a lot of fun. And some of the stuff that we recorded and never got on the disc were pretty crazy. Like there was one where Isutome is the character that I played, and she's in love with Shin. And so she tries to like, you know, work her magic on the family. And so she's sitting there with Shin's dad, and he's about to lay down for a nap. And so she sings him a song. And one of the options that we have that, of course, will never be released because copyrights. Do you guys remember that song, I'm in Love with a Stripper? There's a track of me singing as Isutome. I'm in love with a stripper. She got it. She bought it. She bought it. She hot on that pole. I'm in love with a stripper. And so, like, but you'll never see. It'll never see the light of day because copyrights. But, yeah, sometimes we get to do fun stuff like that. No, I was the snotty little rich bitch. Yeah, Chris Sabat was my butler. Yes. All right, you guys. Well, I guess that's it. I'm going to head downstairs. I've got a little bit of time before I autograph, but I hope to see all of you there. And thanks for coming to see us. We have a voice actor roundtable later on this afternoon, so hopefully I'll see you there. Thanks, you guys.